morning. Today is Friday, January 14th, and welcome to Zoom with Czarny. On today's program, I got Kate Doran of the New York State League of Women Voters. She's an incredible advocate. She's based out of New York City, but helps out the league throughout the state. And we talk about the first day of Democracy Day in the New York Senate with the first day bills, the hope for BOE reform, and also other legislative reforms that will help out the electorate later this session, and her thoughts on a lot of different pending legislation and the role of the League of Women Voters as well in our electoral politics. It's a great conversation. I hope you stick around for it. We're headed into Martin Luther King Jr. Weekend, where most government offices are closed on Monday. And I just wanted to have a little comment on the battle for the soul of our country. Democracy is on the line. And today we are hearing that the Senator Kyrsten Sinema and maybe Senator Joe Manchin are still resistant to changing the filibuster in the New York State Senate to pass the For the People Act and the Electoral Count Reform Act and other, and the John Lewis Voting Rights Act, which are necessary. As we see across this country, state legislators are passing bills designed to restrict the vote. And there was nothing that Martin Luther King stood for more than empowering and enfranchising everyday Americans and making sure that the franchise of voting is spread to all Americans. So I hope over this weekend that every senator, Democrat and Republican, but let's face it, it's rests on the Democratic senators in the United States to pass these reforms when they come back from this holiday, because they are vital, they are needed. And we are very much looking at a existential threat to democracy here in America. So I hope that they will get that working and get those bills passed and overcome whatever qualms they might have about the filibuster, which is standing in the way of so much good in the United States Senate, but most importantly, in the way of actually treating citizens equally across this country by protecting the right to vote. So I hope you stick around for my interview here with Kate Doran of the League of Women Voters. And and I hope that you are well and safe, and are thinking about this weekend what you can do for democracy. So here's my interview with Kate Doran. Bye-bye. I'm very happy to have my good friend Kate Doran. She's an election specialist for off-board at New York City for the League of Women Voters in New York State. And I want to welcome her to Zoom with Czarny. Kate, thank you so much for coming on.
Well, thank you. It's my pleasure to be invited to speak to your listeners and viewers.
Yes. Kate, you and I know each other a little while. We always talk to each other at conference. And I know, of course, what the League of Women Voters is, but it's one of the more venerable voting rights agencies in America. But I think that some of our viewers may not know that the League of Women Voters, what it does. So, Kate, what is the League of Women Voters of New York State?
The League of Women Voters is an outgrowth of the New York State Women's Suffrage Party, because as many people I believe know, the Constitution of the United States did not recognize that women had the right to vote until 1920. So there were hundreds of years, maybe not hundreds, but more than 100 years before that, when women were lobbying and protesting and demanding the right to vote. So there were suffrage parties all over the country. And the New York State Women's Suffrage Party morphed in November of 1919 into the League of Women Voters of New York State. And there was one in Onondaga County in 1919.
Well, that's...
That became the League of Women Voters of Syracuse.
Yeah, well, Onondaga County has a venerable history in the women's suffrage movement, because we are the home of Matilda Jocelyn Gage, and one of the founders of the Seneca Falls Women's Convention. And we actually, if you have not gone there, viewers, go there in Fayetteville, New York. We have the Matilda Jocelyn Gage House, so please go there and learn about our role in women's suffrage right here in Onondaga County. And the League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan, and you have chapters, here in the Onondaga Metro area. I think it's called the Metro League of Women Voters of Onondaga
County. Syracuse Metro League, yes.
Syracuse Metro League. And they have been excellent. The Jones there. there's two Jones that have been involved. And you may have seen their letters to the editor on redistricting and supporting boards of elections and supporting early voting. The League of Women Voters has actually been a big supporter of the reforms that have happened in New York elections since 2019. Can you tell us about your role in advocating for like early voting and some of these other changes we've seen?
Oh, absolutely. But we can't take all the credit. We are part of what's called the Let New York Vote Coalition. Yep. And we have strong alliances with Common Cause, with Citizens Union, with lesser alliances with those organizations which are highly partisan. But we've been working in voting reform and voting rights since the beginning. I mean, we understood that getting women the right to vote was not the end of the work we were going to be doing. So we're proud of our relationship, and we're known as one of the legacy organizations because we're so old.
Kate, what do you do with the League of Women Voters? I know you're the election specialist off board with New York City, and you're on board as well with the state organization. What are your roles with the League of Women Voters?
I'm good at monitoring and paying attention, and that's the role that I've had for many, many years now. I specifically monitor the commissioners' meetings in the city of New York. They meet every week. And there are 10 of them because the election law specifies that they operate as one board of elections. So there are 5 counties in New York City. Each county in the state of New York has one Democrat and one Republican commissioner of elections. So in New York City, the 5 counties are represented by 10 commissioners. So I pay attention to them. I write a report once a week that I distribute to interested parties and those in the voter coalition and some and others. And I'm trying to persuade and train other members of the League of Women Voters throughout New York State to do the same thing, to develop relationships with their boards of election. And I know that they are very fond of you, Dustin. I hear all the time that they are treated with courtesy and respect, but that's not true all over the state, and we'd like to change that because we think we have a lot to offer.
Well, I think we all have to work together. I mean, yes, I consider myself a good ally of the Let New York Vote Coalition. Not a member. I have my own caucus, and we have our own ideals. But most of the time, the Democratic Caucus of Commissioners are definitely aligned with Let New York Vote. Sometimes we have to say, hey, like, you know, this reform that you want, it won't work this way. We have to figure out how to make it work. And I think we always have a constructive conversation when that happens. You know, speaking of reform, we did see, once again, the New York Senate first day of legislation came in this Monday and had Democracy Day and passed, I believe it was 9 different bills that they got through committee and passed in the first day. What are some of the bills that got passed that you were very much supportive of, or hoping that the assembly will pass as well? Maybe all of them, but what are some of the highlights?
Wonderful question, Dustin. I'm delighted to answer that question. We totaled up 10 or 11, maybe. Yes. Anyhow, the one that's last on my list here is the most important to us, and it's Senator Kavanaugh's bill, S 2951, which will reduce the time to register to vote to the constitutional mandate of 10 days. And we sincerely believe that it's about time to do this. This can be done legislatively. It's a little teeny workaround for the defeat of the constitutional amendment last November. But we don't live in an analog paper-based world anymore. And I believe that 10 days is plenty of time for boards of elections. We believe that plenty of time for boards of elections to collect registration forms and get those names on the lists in time for whatever election event is coming up. So that's the most important for us. We love the extension of the sunset for people who don't want to vote in person. We like all of them, frankly.
Yeah, and like, again, this is where I'm an ally of the Let New York Vote Coalition and the League of Women Voters, but the 10-day thing, that is where like our commissioners are wondering how we're going to get that done. So we're not against it yet. We recognize the governor and the Senate Democrats made that a priority. So we're hoping to have a conversation as this bill works through the assembly, because we have some real worries, you know, because early voting starts on the 10th day. So our poll books have to be programmed well before the 10th day, which means if the deadline is the 10th day, then there's going to be a lot of people whose names don't get into the books. So what happens with those? How do we get their votes counted? They're not going to be able to vote on the machine if their name's not in the books. And so these are the type of regulations that we're hoping to see discussed before it becomes law, because
I absolutely appreciate that, and we in the League of Women Voters will help you educate voters. We will absolutely get out there. If we get this law passed, we'll let people know, don't wait till the last minute, get that registration in. But there is an interesting opportunity with what we're calling that golden day, which would turn into an early voting on early voting, same day registration day, wouldn't it? Registered vote on the same day.
Yeah, I think
would that work?
That'll be easy. That'll be easy. I'm not worried about that. I'm worried about the people that are postmarking registrations or doing the DMV in that last week, because that's what I get worried about, is that those names aren't going to be ready. I live right next to Oneida County. I watched what happened when people didn't get registered by election day. So I live in fear of that. I'm very proudful that we've never had that happen in Onondaga County. And I don't want to have a situation where, because of a change in law without the proper regulations, that happens. But I am absolutely 100% with you on the sunset for COVID, because, and I think that's really important, because we have village elections starting in March, and February 1st, we'll start sending out absentee ballots for village elections across the state. And right now, COVID is not a valid excuse for village elections until it gets passed by the assembly and signed by the governor. And this is, with Omicron rearing its head, this is very important. It's very important to get done.
Well, we noted that there is a bill sponsored by Senator Mayer, 7619, that applies to school district elections. Yep. Same thing. I mean, voters who are concerned about voting in person because of an epidemic or a disease. So I'm not as familiar with school board elections, being from New York City, but I understand that that's a big deal in your part of the state.
Yeah, because school districts can decide how to run their own elections. We don't run them at the boards of elections. And the process for absentee voting before COVID was spotty at best. I mean, some districts even said there was none, and that was fine, because they run their own elections. Or there was no clear process for how to get them. And then, of course, in 2020, when we did all mail elections for these school boards, we saw record turnout, you know, because people, didn't have to go to the polls. And so then, in 2021, when we went back to kind of in-person and absentee turnout dropped because we weren't mailing everybody a ballot, but they at least had absentee in place. And so yes, the mayor bill is important. What are you hoping to see come out of this legislative session? I mean, those first day bills, we hope a lot of them are passed, if not all of them. What hasn't been addressed yet that you're, you know, it's only been the first couple of days of session, but what are you hoping to work on over the next few months to make elections better in New York?
Okay, don't get scared now, Dustin. But
I'm ready.
We at the League are very, very interested in structural reform of the Board of Elections statewide, such that there will be greater accountability and that there will be consistency amongst the counties so that we don't have things like happened in Oneida County or happened in Rensselaer County. I mean, I know New York City gets pilloried in the press, but that's partly because we have so many press in New York City, right? But the New York City commissioners really, really tend to pay close attention to the law. And our beef with the New York City folks is that they're really not accountable. I mean, you can't get the city council to tell them what to do. And when they try to, the New York City board says, we're a creature of the state. And then we go in circles. But that's something we would like to see that it's not part of any of these bills that were passed by the Senate in the first day.
I'm for structural reform in certain senses, but I'm not for ending the bipartisan boards. I believe bipartisan boards are essential to assuring the vote and having, and I will fight for bipartisan boards because I also believe that they're independent. I see these other boards in other states that are elected county clerks or run by an elected secretary of state, and then there's ideology issues that come into play. Yeah. Whereas having, and especially up in New York, up in upstate New York, I have a Republican county executive. I have a Republican county legislature. By me being the Democrat at the board, I get to represent the voters that are not the Republicans and the ideology that's not in power. And I think across upstate New York, if you give it to the hands of the elected officials, you might have some real disparate differences from county to county. There's already disparate differences that in terms of budgeting. And in some of these counties, the Democrat might be the only public official that's a Democrat, but yet there are Democratic voters in that county.
We get that. But what we're hearing in counties like the five in New York City and places like Westchester and Nassau is, what happens when these folks screw up? You can't ask to speak to their boss and get them, you know, reprimanded. Nothing can happen. We are really, really serious about some sort of structure that creates accountability that the voters would understand.
And I think that's where we find a lot of agreement across the board, because even with Democratic commissioners, we came out for standardized training that is at the state board level, mandated to be done for each county commissioner each year. And we also came out for, and I think this surprised a lot of people, but we came out for the power of removal of a commissioner for malfeasance by the state board. You know, I mean, we're putting our own heads on the chopping block, but we believe in accountability too.
Good.
You know, so the Democratic commissioners, our caucus has already come out for that. And I testified for that during the MIRE reform hearings. So I agree with that. Accountability, we need to be accountable. We need to be accountable to the public, and we need to be accountable, our parties as well, but more to the public than the parties, in my opinion. The parties play a role in finding and nominating commissioners. I believe that's important, but we need to, once we're in, we need to serve the voters. And I believe most do, but when there are bad apples, they need to be brought to bear. I know we are in agreement of another thing, which is resources for boards of elections to carry out their
mission. Yes, sir. So, we believe apart from New York City, the boards of elections throughout the state are woefully underfunded, and we would love to see more resources. And we are definitely in your corner in that regard. They need to be. I mean, you need to have websites that are updated on a continual basis. You need lawyers to help you so you don't make, you know, mistakes. And you need all kinds of things that I know you don't have. And many, many counties are probably more resource starved than yours.
Yeah. Well, yes. Although I will note that I have the least full-time employees to voter ratio in the state in Onondaga County.
I'll make a note of that.
Yeah. I mean, and there are bills going in about that, which I hope the state legislature will pass, which will give us some kind of, you know, minimum salary structures and minimum staffing structures for local boards. Because outside of New York City and Nassau and maybe Erie County, outside of that, you really see a disparate situation, for boards of elections. And with all these reforms coming our way, we need the people to put them in place.
Absolutely.
What was the league's position on the absentee ballot changes that are coming now in 2022 we're going to start counting those absentee ballots before election day? Because this is going to be a big change for New York, and we're going to need everybody's help in, you know, doing voter education, which I know you will do. But what was your position on that?
Well, I must say, Dustin, that we don't have a specific position on this. And it's New York State's method for allowing voters to vote absentee and then show up at the poll site is unique, I believe, in the country, right?
Yeah.
And the hue and cry was, why should it take so long? Why should we have to wait so long for the outcome of our elections? What we did do, you may know, but we were the league, apart from the Let New York Vote Coalition, was responsible for the changes that protected the voters, allowing them to cure errors in their absentee ballots.
Yep.
And that is a very, very big deal. I've been in the room when I had permission once to be in the room when the absentee ballots were coming in and they were being looked at. And this is a very big deal. To be able to, if you fail to sign the envelope, to be able to have someone call you and bring you back in. But we're really still on the fence about these timing changes. We certainly want the voters to have as much time as possible, but it feels like tension between the media and the public, that they want things fast and to serve the voters in the way they need to be served. So I don't know, are you willing to share what the election commissioners think about all of this?
Well, so we advised on, it was more like, if this is the legislator's goal to do this, here's how we can do it and get it done in a legal and proper way. So, and I think we made the bill better than what it originally was. I personally was for this bill very much, even though some will see it as a stripping of a right to go to the polls and supplant your absentee. But as you said, that's unique in the country. And if you're the only one doing something, you're either way ahead of the field or way behind. And New York tends to be way behind.
But
because of that rule, that is why we couldn't count absentees until weeks after the election to be able to make sure that nobody voted on election day. So this process also will protect those absentee voters from those horrible challenges that we've seen in the last couple of years as polarization of voting methods have come into play where, you know, more Democrats tend to be early voting and absentee voting than Republicans because of their national rhetoric. And so these protections that are coming into place, I think, are going to be just as important as getting results on election night. So, but right. I think also having results on election night will remove the perception that somehow people are being cheated, even though they weren't. Everybody gets a right to vote. But what we've seen over the last few years is this like red shift on election or red mirage on election day and then a blue shift afterwards. Right. And then of course that feeds into the big lie. And if all the results were reported at once or 95% of the results were reported at once, that would go away, you know, for the most part. So that's why I was for it.
Yes, yes. As I say, the League of Women Voters has not taken a position on this particular thing, but I will tell you, this is going to be easier to message than the other way of saying, well, you can vote absentee, but then if you really want to, you can go and vote in person, and then we have to wait for a week before anything happens.
Yeah, there'll be a sea change just like there was with early voting. But I think, you know, within a couple cycles, we figured out what early voting, you know, the public understood what early voting was, even though they hadn't seen it before. And again, most of the country does this already. All of the country does this besides us. So I think this is something that we can do. So there was a report that came out today. We're recording this on Wednesday. This will be airing on Friday. But there's a report that came out today, you know, hitting the boards of elections a little bit. And I was in that report, and but I know you sent it to me, and I think it was important to talk about. So, Kate, can you talk about that report and maybe what the League's position is on that?
Sure. This is a group I'm very unfamiliar with, but I'm thrilled to get to know them now. That concerns itself with. The open meetings law and the FOIA, which is the request for information from by public citizens, ordinary people from governments. And they are saying that many, many of the boards of elections in New York State are in violation of the law of these laws. And they chose, I believe, 19 separate counties they reached out to. They did not reach out to New York City. I found that interesting. But they did reach out to your county, to you, Dustin, in Onondaga. They reached out to Westchester, Nassau, and Suffolk. Westchester, Nassau, and Suffolk ignored them. And they're just trying to find out, do you hold meetings? As commissioners, do you hold meetings? Are those meetings public such that the voters could come and watch them on webcast, in a webcast format, or show up at the meetings? And if you hold these meetings, do you create minutes and do you post the minutes? And it was alarming to see how few of the boards of election that they studied did those things that would make transparency apparent to the public.
So this has been an ongoing discussion at boards of elections. I'll tell you, Onondaga County is middle of the road. We hold meetings. We have minutes. We don't post them on our website yet, and we don't we don't post notices on our website. And I'll be honest, the reason that was is because when I became commissioner, we didn't even have meetings back in 2013, and it took a while for me to convince my fellow commissioner, both of the Republican commissioners I've served with, that this is the proper rule. There is a lot of discussion in the election community about whether we are covered under open meetings law. Different county attorneys have weighed in on this and said one way or another. I personally believe we are, but I can't necessarily make my colleagues do it so I've stressed to legislators, they need to make this explicit as part of legislation. They can easily write a code into New York election law saying that all boards of elections must follow open meetings laws, and then that would end it, right? That would end the discussion. We'd have to do it. And I think that's part of the problem. And I think, you know, that's kind of like the part of the problem with elections in general sometimes, is that we have these antiquated New York laws that have been around since, you know, the turn of the century and the turn of the last century. And, they not everything has been updated to where it needs to be, and we shouldn't be afraid to update it. So, yeah, but
may I pose a question to you?
Absolutely. Yes.
What would, if the ladies and gentlemen at the State Board of Elections were to issue sort of a dictate to the county boards and say, we believe that we are subject to the New York State Open Meetings Law, and we want you to do A, B, C, and X, Y, Z. How do you think the county commissioners would react to that?
Oh, I think that I think that would be very strong. I think that would be something I do know that many of these people at the state board believe we follow under those laws as well. And I know the state board commissioners act under those laws when they meet as well. I don't know if they've gone so far, and if they have, I don't know about it, to actually issue regulations that county boards should follow, monthly meetings, open meeting laws, those kind of things. I would welcome.
Right.
I always welcome. I want the State Board of Elections to be more regulatory in nature and less guidance. I want regulations. I want to be told what, you know, I don't need them to tell me how to do, you know, thing everything in the office, but tell me how a board of elections should run in terms of, you know, procedures that will keep us safe and keep the public informed. Right. That's something that I think would be very welcome to many of us who are commissioners who believe we should have open meetings. There are commissioners who don't believe that. Some of them on my side of the aisle. So they won't welcome it at all. But I think it
also would provide a certain amount of cover and protection. I mean, if you're following directives that are coming down from the State Board of Elections, you can say, look, this is what they're telling us to do.
And most of the time, that's how we resolve disputes inside the county boards, is that we go to the state board, and we do more often than not get guidance, and then we resolve, you know, one way or the other. Right. So, but yes, no, that would be something that would be very beneficial, I think.
I noticed that there are even in my world, the world that I live in, the advocacy and good government world, many people don't realize that you folks in the Election Commissioners Association are much older than the State Board of Elections.
That's right.
The State Board of Elections has only been around since 1974. Yeah. And I do notice a little bit of tension there on occasion that, you know, we know what we're doing, leave us alone, that kind of thing. And maybe it will require some strengthening by statute to give the State Board more authority.
I think it's better. I mean, I've only been commissioner since 2013, and I know that I've heard stories of a very adversarial relationship between county boards and state boards for the first 20 years that the state board was in existence. And then it got better over time. I think it's really good right now. I think, it helps that our co-executive director on the Democratic side, Bob Rem, before her, and Kristen, Stabrowski-Savitsky they're both former county commissioners. So that, I think that helps a great deal. You know, and Tom Wilkie before that was an incredible advocate for county boards. So I think that may have made, you know, that relationship better. But yeah, I think we are having to look at in New York, this is my opinion, that the State Board of Elections needs to take more of a less of a guidance counselor role and more of a principal. You know, they need to start managing the ship a little bit more than giving us guidance and letting us go. And I don't mean like micromanaging, but, you know, setting regulations, yeah, setting policy, and coming down with clear instructions. And I think they're leaning towards that too. And I think they're just waiting for the legislature to give them statutory authority to do so.
From our perspective, though, there is an opportunity for gridlock because there are two D's and two R's. And there was a time in the long ago, well, not so long ago past, that the League of Women Voters recommended a fifth commissioner, someone not affiliated with any party at all, so that we could not, we wouldn't encounter this kind of gridlock.
I've heard that recommendation. I've heard that recommendation on the local level to have some kind of third commissioner that is involved too. My problem with that is I think the bipartisan boards in their nature have to come to agreement to move forward. And that forces agreement more than forces gridlock. Yes, there are cases of gridlock, but I think what I get worried about is when there's a third party involved, that partisanship will come into play. And I know we say, oh, well, they're not involved, registered in a party. What's to keep the, you know, the county exec's cousin from de-enrolling in the Republican Party a month before he gets appointed, you know?
There would have to be statute or regulations, yeah, saying that person could not have been connected to the party for how many, several years, whatever.
Yeah, but I mean, even if you're not registered in the party, you can have connections to ideology and, you know, and who appoints that person. There's no party structure for non-enrolled voters for them to make an appointment of a non-enrolled. So are we then giving elected officials too much power over the Board of Elections by giving them the tie-breaking vote on every single decision? That is where I get... I get worried. What I would rather have is a mediation system that will help mediate disputes that stay out of court. So like, let's say we, and I think some of that might be solved with the New York Voting Rights Act. That's why I'm a big fan of the John Lewis New York Voting Rights Act, because—
We are as well.
And my previous guest was Perry Grossman, and of NYCLU. He was a big fan and author of co-author and helping Ann behind the scene on that. And he really went into what's part of that package that will make election administration better too. So check out that Zoom if you're listening. It's the one right before this.
Perry Grossman represented us when we sued the state. That is when the State League of Women Voters sued the State Board of Elections regarding the harmonizing the 25 days that's in the statute versus the 10 days that's. Yep. And we have to get back with Perry to see where we stand there. Yeah, he's a relative father, and he's excited about that role.
Yes, he is, and I think, you know, that kind of went away when we were all thinking that we were all going to get same day registration. Exactly. And we recognize as commissioners, now that same day registration is not coming in, something's going to have to give. You know, one of the things that I thought of with the 10 day registration is have 10 day be the in-person deadline, but have 15 days be the mail-in deadline, because then that gives the boards of elections a few days to catch up. And because, you know, and that harmonizes with the absentee ballot mail-in deadline, right, you know, right. So these are thoughts that we're all kind of like banding about to see how we can make this work. Because I think we all recognize that it's not going to be 25 days. So what is it going to be?
Yeah. Well, not to get too wonky, but in the—
I like wonky. That's what we're here for.
You like wonky? Good.
Yeah. This is an election podcast.
Yeah. We are in favor of a postmark date, not a received by date.
So on the absentee ballots.
Yeah.
I agree with that.
And the registration form.
Yes.
And the registration form. Because the voter registration,
yep,
postmark date. Because otherwise, the voter doesn't know. Can they rely on their post office? But they know if they walk in and they get a postmark that they're going to beat the deadline.
I agree with that. I mean, one of the things that like I agreed with the moving back of the absentee ballot request to 15 days because we need time to mail out the ballot to the voters and they need time for it to come to us. But
right,
the receive by date, I feel like and another thing that's coming up this year is the February 14th day. The fall in love with your party Valentine's Day party switch date. That's a received by date too, not a postmarked date, and that confuses voters because they think, oh, if I put this in the mail, it's going to count. Right. And that's another one that I think should be changed as well. And that's not fair
to voters. They have to rely on
So far before the primary. Why is it received by instead of postmarked by? Because it doesn't matter if I get that 2 weeks later, as long as it's postmarked right, I'm going to have them in the records for the June primary. So I don't understand that. I think that's something that we're hopefully maybe that's something that can get done sometime this session, as well, and probably not before February 14th this year. So if you're thinking about your party, do it before, do it before the February 14th deadline.
Right.
So, well, we're kind of getting on that magic 30 minutes, that I have here, but I always end these podcasts with the same question to my guests. What haven't we talked about yet? What is something that you want to get out there that you feel is important, a legislative item, a piece of information about the league, whatever you want. What do you want to leave the listeners with, or one other thing that you want to talk about today?
Well, I want to remind your listeners that the League of Women Voters is a bottom-up organization. When we come to a position, we're not, there isn't some majestic royalty who's saying this is what we should believe because we know best. We have 45 local leagues in New York State, and there are only 700 state and local leagues throughout the entire country. So that's a pretty good percentage, somewhere around 6% are right here in New York State. And we have somewhere between 37 and 3,800 members. So that's a nice grassroots group. And we are now we are launching a study of what we believe election administration should look like in New York State. And we have some ideas. I'm on the committee that's putting the materials together, but we don't decide for the league members. We send these materials out to our leagues and they discuss and they make things better, which is what we hope. But I want to say, I believe in this process. Back in the 2000s, the league studied voting machines in New York State. And we came to the conclusion that the optical scanners and the paper ballots were the best thing for New York State. And we're still proud of our position about that.
Yeah, that was great. I always get to people who are like, oh, let's bring back the lever machines. I'm like, no. They're melted.
Oh my.
They're gone.
Oh my.
I don't want those back.
Oh my. Well, I'm old enough to have voted on them very regularly. And I also was a poll worker back before we had the scanners. And so I remember working on them. But I want to make a plug for the League of Women Voters. We accept all kinds of members. We don't care whether they're women. And we do not care what political party you are affiliated with. We have a sterling reputation for being nonpartisan. And we are very, very interested in working with the boards of elections throughout the state of New York and helping voters to learn what their boards do and help them do a better job.
Well, Kate, thank you so much for taking some time out of your night to come on Zoom and Czarny. And thank you for all you do.
That's a great title. Voters. I love that. Zoom and Czarny.
Zoom and Czarny. I'm all about alliteration. I'm a fiend for it. So so thank you again. Thank you to the League for your leadership and your allyship for democracy. And I want to Thank you once again. And I can't wait to see you once we have our conference in March now, hopefully.
Oh, right, in March. I know. I knew I couldn't make the January one. And when I learned it was postponed, I said, yeah, all right. Okay.
Cool. Thank you. A note to my viewers. I have, I want to again thank Kate for coming on. Next week, I will have I'm not sure who I have. I forgot who. Oh no, no, yes, I know who I am. next week. I should mention that right now on my website on DustinCzarny.com, I have a Wonky Wednesday up, which is all about the nature of voting methods and how it's become polarized over the last 3 years. The differences between the people who use early voting and the people who use election day and the people who use absentees, and how we've seen over the last few years the a lot of people have been I'm sorry a lot of people have been kind of seeing that we are seeing more Republicans vote on early voting and more Democrats on absentee, and that's showing why there's a shift in results. So go check out those stats. Next week on Wonky Wednesday, I'll be talking about my final look back at the general election and how the offices paired out in Onondaga County. Next week on Zoom with Czarny, I'll have Marty Mastropole on, the county comptroller, for his annual check-in. He's the highest ranking Democrat in Onondaga County, and he'll be talking about what his office has done over the last year. And of course, please remember that it is still pretty high caseloads out there with the Omicron COVID-19 variant. We're seeing record numbers of cases. Hospitalizations are going up locally. Please wear your mask when you're inside, and upgrade to the K95 masks or N95s. They're much better at stopping the spread of this virus. Get vaccinated, get boosted. I got boosted just this last week. So I feel very protected, and hopefully we can survive this winter and start getting back to normal sometime this spring, but only if we do the work now. So please go out there, be safe, and go to DustinCzarny.com and subscribe. I will always keep that free, no advertisements, no outside money. I pay for it on my own money, but the subscriptions will help you get posts that you will see any election-related news in Onondaga County, as well as all the content that I bring you. So take care and enjoy your night. Bye-bye.